Hello, are we on? So welcome to the Saturday keynote for this year's V Symposium. I know many of you already, but for those who don't know me, I'm Fuchsia Dunlop, and I've been coming to the symposium for more than 20 years now, and I'm a former trustee, and I'm a specialist in Chinese food. And now we're going to go to China. One of the strangest Western stereotypes of Chinese food is that it's unhealthy. We're somehow always hearing in the media stories about Chinese food being too salty, too fatty, full of MSG, or otherwise unwholesome. And more recently, of course, Chinese food has become tangled up in the coronavirus pandemic and slurred with all kinds of terrible news stories. But the stereotype that Chinese food is unhealthy is particularly strange because few food cultures are so preoccupied with the intimate and intricate links between diet and health as the Chinese. As anyone who's spent time in China or has Chinese friends will know, in Chinese thinking, there's no real division between food and medicine. Every ingredient has its medicinal properties. A balanced diet is seen as fundamental to human health and happiness. And at the first sign of symptoms, most Chinese people look at what they're eating before anything else. And many Chinese medicinal herbs are used not only in medicinal infusions, but also in tonic soups and other dishes that are eaten as part of a normal meal. So with this year's topic of herbs and spices, it's wonderful to be able to welcome as a keynote speaker Vivian Lowe, who's been researching Chinese food, medicine, and exercise traditions for decades. She has a long-standing association with University College London and the Wellcome Trust in London. And later this year, she'll be taking up a post as a professor in the history department at UCL. She's the author of two Chinese cookbooks and is currently working on a history of nutrition in China. She's also contributed to an encyclopedia of Chinese medicine that will come out later this year. Vivian grew up in Britain, but was always surrounded by Chinese food. She's the daughter of the late Kenneth Lowe, who many of you may know, British people may know, who was a former Chinese diplomat who grew up between Fujian province in China and London, and ended up writing more than 40 cookbooks, becoming a TV chef, opening the restaurant Memories of China, and playing a really prominent role in introducing British people to Chinese food. I'm just going to post in a chat, I'm going to post a list of Vivian's publications and books in case anyone is interested. And in the meantime, Vivian, over to you.
Thank you, Fuchsia. Can everybody hear me? Can you all hear me? Can you see me? Okay, cool. I'm delighted to be here. And first of all, I'd like to thank everybody for inviting me. That must include Claudia, Elizabeth, Ursula, and Fuchsia herself. I hardly have to say anything more after Fuchsia has, you know, basically said everything that I'm going to say in the next 45 minutes. Beautiful introduction. Thank you very much. The main thing I want to do is share my screen now. And I'm not seeing. Oh, okay, here we go. I'm going to start now. With Yuan Mei, and are we seeing that? Okay, I hope so. Okay, so the title of this presentation is Potent Flavors, Nutritional Practice in the Sinosphere and Beyond. I'm going to start with a quotation from Yuan Mei's 18th century cookbook. Yuan Mei reminds us about the synesthetic experience of flavor. So how food hits us in the eyes and nose first, before it hits the tongue. sometimes clear like autumn clouds and beautiful like amber. And Yuen Mei was a southerner, so basically sugar was keen on the sugary flavor as the core to food. There are of course many Chinas, not all of them have such a concentration on sugar as he does. And he says, do not, however, rely on the spices, because if you do too much spice, the essence of food will be destroyed. There are two things to note here, the sugar at the center, and this is somehow representative of a kind of centralist Chinese narrative, that earth and sugar are related, the yellow earth of China, the yellow river, and the sweet flavor. But there are many narratives about what China may or may not be. And the other, that he is a southerner, and so therefore it's geographic. There's a kind of geographic basis of flavor. But then also, finally, what is the essence of food? I'm gonna stop sharing for a minute. Most complex societies have codified their foods and investing in them a significance beyond just satisfying hunger. Culinary technology in China, for example, links to a history of nutritional ideas that goes back at least 2,500 years and has echoes today in everyday life for over a billion people, and many more if we count those Chinese in diaspora living overseas in what we might call the Sinosphere, where people still speak Chinese languages. People in China are inclined to have a view about what they eat and about the effect of what they eat on their bodies. They have an opinion about the techniques of adjusting food to their own constitution, to their own palate, and how individual ingredients in a dish change its nutritional value. They think about their foods in unique ways. So this lecture is dedicated to understanding how those ideas came about historically and to explaining some of those background assumptions that have informed these collective practices that surround us. This is not only a historical ethnographic survey aimed at understanding other people, but it also is interested in how Chinese cuisine and Chinese medicine are relevant to all of us because of the ideas as well as the people have been in diaspora too. So it's important for all those who care about the relationships between global and local attitudes to health and to patterns of assumptions of consumption. China seems to me to be at a critical moment when global cultures are changing traditional patterns of healthcare, very often for the worse. Despite extraordinary public health achievements in the 20th century, there is now an epidemic of obesity in China, especially amongst the young. And there's a marked increase in first world illnesses like diabetes. When I first arrived in China during the 1980s, every railway station was absolutely surrounded by vendors selling foods of all kinds. It was really exciting. Every kind of snack, but now the ultra modern and super hygienic concourses of the stations are home to McDonald's, KFC, and all the Chinese counterparts of fast food chains. It's a very sad testimony to the ways that Chinese American styles of nutrition have affected China and what was an extremely vibrant culinary culture. Nevertheless, at home and abroad, elderly Chinese people keep those cultures alive, and I believe that those cultures have a very positive effect on their health, much more effective than these public health directives to eat five a day, something that I barely ever achieve and just makes me feel guilty. Elderly Chinese care about their foods. They take time over it. They shop, they cook, and they eat small amounts of meat and lots of greens, and they know about their greens. They know all those amazing kinds of greens in the supermarkets, which I barely know. That is good for them and it's good for the environment. They pay attention to seasonal eating and they eat local produce that is available locally. And they talk endlessly about the nutritional qualities of their food. The mutual interactions of different kinds of foods, according to ancient precepts. They share their food, spend a lot of time shopping, eating, and cooking together, keeping trim, and they show their care and their pride in a knowledge of their food ways through cooking. These food ways link to this nutritional, the history of nutritional ideas, and remains a part of medical lore today. I, for example, have a excess of damp, or so I'm told, and so shouldn't eat a lot of fats and sweet things. Now, that's pretty universal in any healthy nutritional regimen. They assigned the Chinese, so like the ancient Greeks, Chinese designed foods that were deemed suitable for various states of imbalance according to a system of food potencies and flavors. They assigned qualities to food like heating, cooling, things that are astringent or moving the qi or the energy down in one's body. Of moving it into different organs like the kidneys or the heart. Where China differs from Europe is that those ideas and practices are still very, very vibrant in Chinese culture, in popular culture. Nutritional culture was never limited to curing illness. The potential for foodstuffs to fortify and stimulate the body was well known in ancient China. Food and drugs were an integral part of a regimen aimed at making you feel better, at longevity and even immortality. I'm going to share my screen again. Okay. Is that sharing?
Yes.
Okay, good. So, food has always been intimately linked to politics. The art of proper seasoning and the mastery of cooking techniques became customary metaphors for good government. Tiaogong, or seasoning the stew, being a synonym, I can't say that word, for the work of the minister of state, who mixed and adjusted and regulated government policies until the perfect mix was achieved. The gong, the soup, or the stew, was the most common and easiest preparation for meats. Common plants that could enrich the stock to increase the stew's savouriness were celery and the alliums, or the less familiar bitter tastes of sow thistle leaves, or liao, a type of smartweed, and of course wine, as well as a selection of fruits, spices, and seasoning. Perhaps sweet flavours like malt or honey were also added, but as likely the stew would have been thickened with sweet flavours like grain, for example, like rice, broken rice. The most fundamental of the categories that they thought with, of the nutritional categories, was that of yin and yang, which ordered the world in terms of complementary oppositions. But before these ideas became part of a system of medicine, they were a system of ritual and codified in imperial ritual particularly. Behavior throughout the year was in theory structured to the yin and yang cycles. And what we have here is the way in which a civilized gentleman was advised to deport himself in the Lu Shi Chen Qiu, a ritual encyclopedia compiled in 239 BCE by Lu Bu Wei, one of the key advisors to, and some say even the father of the first emperor of China, although that was a slander by the grand historian Sima Qian. But what we see here in this ritual advice for this and gentlemen is basically restraint, not much fun, no music and sex, no piquant condiment. So again, reiterating the later Yuan Mei. The passage is concerned with practices to calm and quieten the body in order to align the body with the cosmic cycles operating at the onset of yin. So that's the coolest, most inactive part of the year and basic seasonal living. This was the time when one's behavior should follow the spirit of the season and be most conservative. Yet with the the seasonal prohibition of pleasure and indulgence in deep winter, there was also a strong moral censure at work. And one can find this moral censure, regardless of the season, in other writings, religious writings, medical writings, government writings. No doubt, new disparities of wealth during the Han Dynasty and these first empires were responsible for the censure of excessive behavior. By Han times, so we're in 200 BC to 200 AD, by Han times there was clearly an awareness of how overeating, neglect of the signs of physical breakdown, a lack of medical sophistication would bring ill health. In the earliest extant manuscript devoted to an early form of acupuncture, which has been much of my research, we find very clear knowledge of the link between certain types of pain, overeating, overweight, and diseases of the blockage of blood flow, which resulted in an urgent attack on the heart. If left untreated, the sound of crying will be heard. That is, if you overeat, it's a condition that will lead to sudden death. This prohibition against excess also played out in an enduring tension between eating the most simple of foods, the most basic, plain of foods, and on the contrary, being able to celebrate your power and mastery of the world from the central seat of government in China by eating all of its flavors. So we have a tension that still exists today in the same way. For example, the prohibition against excess also played out in, so when millet is boiled, for example, millet being one of the major staples of North China, it makes a zhou, a congee, perhaps you know it as. It was highly treasured in early China and yet remains prized today for its restorative functions. There were many different kinds of zhou from different places. It can be further sweetened with fruits such as hongzhao, that's red date, or jujube, or served savory with meat and pickles for breakfast in preparations that are easily digested by the elderly and sick, and by children, of course. Like Lu Buwei and all of his compilers of the Spring and Autumn Annals of Master Lu, aficionados of zhou, of congee, still express preferences for millet. One of my dear friends, Li Ling, who's an eminent historian and archaeologist at Peking University, advised me only to eat the form of millet from Qingzhou in Shandong province, which is easily available still in supermarkets, which demonstrates an enduring preference for certain of the cultural elite for particular local varieties of foods. And here is a recipe given to me by a Cantonese chef who was a friend of one of my children, this is one which is very, very tasty. Rice flavored with dried scallops, which I think are a little difficult to get these days, peanut oil, which may cause serious allergy, and lean pork, but extremely tasty. So in foodstuffs, the allopathic oppositions of heating and cooling, or upwards and downwards, so purgatives and emetics, are most often encountered. We know, of course, ginger is heating, sweet foods are warming, and the bitter herbs are cooling. But also, there was a kind of seasonal homeopathy, where things that are alike resonate sympathetically according to the theories of the five agents. So something that's rather different from eat cold things to cool yourself. The five agents, the theories of the five agents were the regulated interactions of wood, fire, earth, metal, and water. Some people know that as the five elements. And in this case, their correspondence with the flavors, which are respectively sour, bitter, sweet, pungent, and salty. Recommendations therefore existed to eat foods that supported the season. Thus in spring, liver qi and the acid or sour flavor predominated. So one should eat foods from these categories and less of others. Here is the zhou li, the rites of zhou, which is a treatise of the late Warring States that purports anachronistically to record the bureaucracy serving the imperial courts of the Zhou kings. It describes an idealized staff all involved in handling the foods of the sovereign, including dietetic physicians. In this coat, where we are being cautioned to eat in a way that follows the season, and we can see how each substance was not only attributed with yin and yang qualities, but it also had a way, the flavor, or a flavor which had medicinal potencies, because it corresponded to one of the five agents, wood, fire, earth, metal, and water. And this would form the basis of Chinese nutritional science that became ever more complex. So here is wheat. Wheat is associated with the wood element, and it should be eaten in spring because all of these things resonate together. So here in the earliest extant manual of therapeutic exercise, which I've translated and you can download, you can find that in the chat. It was excavated from a grave of 186 BC. There are also recommendations about seasonal deportment. So as well as all these prohibitions against excess, you can find standard medical texts which tell you that autumn is the time for excess. Autumn is the time to wash your hair a lot and eat your fill. Have sex, enter the chamber is a euphemism for having sex. So have as much sex as you want. And this is the way to deport yourself. So winter and autumn, very different. The five flavors also generally referred to the range of sensual pleasures that one might dream of consuming. Here is another passage from that same spring and autumn annals of Master Lu, where those at the epicenter of power at the court of the first emperor were dreaming of mastering the whole of the empire by eating all of its flavors. Here we have ginger, of course, but ginger from a very specific locality. Cinnamon, also from a specific locality. And then you have bamboo shoots and sturgeon, salt from Daxia, water. So in these early times, we do not find the fully developed medical nutritional system that stems from late Han. We're still 400 years before that. But since at that early time, the correspondences were mainly concerned with ritual and political behavior. Early second century BC medical theories was most obviously developing in the context at that time of sexual cultivation and breath meditation. This was a world of restraint aimed at honing the senses and making one sharp and astute. So here, be careful about what you drink, because you have to put your qi in order. And once your qi is in order, your whole body will be a tool which will be bright and clear. Your skin will gleam and the yin will rise. The yin in this context is actually a direct euphemism for the penis. And you will therefore live forever. But the sexual and culinary pleasures are also thinly disguised. We can see that in many, many aphrodisiac recipes that are found in the same tombs. So this one I just put there for a bit of fun, but you can see here so many euphemisms for the penis and for the genitalia, for the female genitalia as well. I think there are about six or seven just in that small passage. I always give that to my undergraduates when they're looking bored. So see how many penises and vaginas you can find there. Basically, it's telling you to eat eggs. But here is another recipe, which is much more complex, with pine truffles and ginger and cinnamon, but it's actually for inserting inside the woman. So there's all kinds of things you can do with spices to affect your health. Let's take one of the examples from the Ma Wandui tomb, which is to see how medicinal foods were developing over the course of the 400 years of the Han Dynasty. Aromatics were commonly placed in bags like these, some of them in wonderful silks. And So they were placed in bags and pillows, and these were thought to have a medicinal effect as protection against demonic causes of disease. So I'm just going to choose particularly one of the herbs that were often chosen and very much in evidence in this tomb, in honor of Fuchsia, who knows so much more about Sichuan pepper than I do. Many of the pillows and spice bags from early imperial China were filled with forms of pepper from West and Southwest China. And it's definitely the case that these were traveling to the Roman world within a very small time of this. And here, at the end of the Han Dynasty, we see the Shenlong Bunsao Jing, the classic pharmacopoeia of the Heavenly Husbandman, talking about the Sichuan peppers. This is the entry for Qinjiao and Shujiao as they appear in the earliest extant systematic Materia Medica to detail the action of herbs, drugs, and foodstuffs, the Shenlong Bunsao Jing. These are two similar peppercorns grown, recorded as growing in two areas, in Qin, roughly modern Shanxi and eastern Gansu, and Shu, roughly modern Sichuan, both of which are widely used still in contemporary China. So here we see that the spices generally, and it does say so here, but the spices, as opposed to other kinds of foods, tend to enter the body through the airways, and it's very specific about that, and actually is a way of defining what constitutes a spice in Chinese foodways. And here you see also is both these are pungent, so they are pungent, they enter the lungs, they're warming, and they also drugs, they're like drugs of immortality. They make you sharp and bright, and they give you a good complexion, bearing up to old age, prolonging your life and connecting you with the spirits. So there's a kind of magical quality to these spices. And so after long-term use, the hair will not whiten, it lightens the body, and life will be prolonged. It grows in the mountains and valleys, which gives you a magical kind of correspondence here. So in this medical context, the five flavors could stimulate certain movements of qi, that is the essential part of life. Also in the tomb, the same tombs at Ma Wan Dui, we find all of these spices, all of which have the same kind of medical efficacy. So ginger, we know, cinnamon, magnolia, all these other ones which are slightly less common to us, as well as hua jiao, the Sichuan peppers. So in the classification of foods that we understand as having been much more systematized by the end of the Han, we find that qi is animating and invigorating the body and inducing movements through the flavors. They could affect the organ and channel systems and treat specific symptoms of illness. In this way, the right foods would make a person astute, healthy, and effective. Sweet, for example, was thought slightly yang in nature and promoting an upward and outward movement. It entered the stomach and spleen channels, making you feel much more stable and earthing you. Mildly sweet foods such as grains, nuts, and fruits and many vegetables should form the main bulk of a diet. Stronger sweet flavors should be avoided by people like me with signs of damp. Salt moistens the body, sour gathered and contracted, cleansing the body and moving the blood. Salt entered the kidneys and sour the liver. Bitter was the most yin of flavors, so therefore very good for yang conditions such as fever, caused contraction and made qi descend. It was also drying and good for dampness. So bitter entered the heart, clearing heat and calming the spirit. So most of the spices had this pungent flavor, as I said, so they were youthful, they were making you youthful, lightening your spirit, creating the conditions for your immortality and youth. In practice, these flavors had to be balanced, and this was achieved in different ways, but one of them was by adding that the sugar, the crystal sugar, as Yuen Mei would say. But most fundamentally, these sweet foods related to agency of earth and were used to achieve this balance and to counteract the effect of very strong spices. And that's something we might reflect on later. So medical advice from the medieval period advised, beginning with this dietary medicine, the gentler dietary therapy. Sun Si Miao of the 6th-7th century famously likened the use of drugs to the violent action of soldiers. The best doctors would diagnose and treat the body with dietary advice before illness manifested, and paid very careful attention to the tradition of food combinations and prohibitions. Elsewhere, we find here is Sun Si Miao on the tiger. He's very often depicted on a tiger because he's controlling this animal force, animal energy. But elsewhere, we find Sun Si Miao talking about the essence of the food, just as Yuen Mei did. And for him, it meant the essence of the food could be damaged by the combination of the wrong flavors. And what are the wrong flavors is what I try to analyze. But basically, there are many, many different ideas about it. Sometimes the wrong flavors are local. People have different preferences for different kinds of foods. Sometimes in particular localities, people are thought to have certain types of constitution, and therefore certain types of food are good for them. To Sun, the essence of the food was exactly that of the five flavors and their ability to change the physiology of the body. There were therefore prohibitions about flavor combinations that stemmed from the interaction between the five agents: wood, fire, earth, metal, and water. Traditional food prohibitions embrace overlapping magical ritual and empirical knowledge about food hygiene and seasonal eating. They include Buddhist precepts that strive for purification of your diet, Taoist proscriptions on the eating of grains, and a lot of fasting. So anything that actually makes you defecate a lot was not thought to be good. The traditional nutritional science of the correct flavors combinations and their influences on the inner organs, not to speak of these regional culinary wisdoms about what combinations are essentially unpalatable. Middle-aged Chinese are generally able to tell you that a crab must be eaten with ginger to counteract its cold qualities. Walnuts are a tonic for the brain and the kidneys and increase your sexual potency, and that's obviously because walnuts look like the brain, so kind of sympathetic magic. Jujube enriches the blood, chrysanthemum tea and steamed fish are cooling, mandarins are heating, and bean curd should not be eaten with vinegar. It goes on and on. Many recommendations concern pregnancy. If you eat fish soup, the child will blow bubbles. If you look at a hare, the child will be born with a split lip. And steamed carp increases the flow of breast milk. Here we have, so in general, religious precepts demanded restraint with the distinct moral overtone aimed at the leisure classes. Too much strong meat, spice, oil, and fat would create excess heat. Garlic or ginger on the breath will attract ghosts who will want to come and lick your lips. Nowadays, one can pick up shrink-wrapped packs of goji berries to strengthen blood and yin. Hongzhao, jujube, and chrysanthemum tea in every cosmopolitan city in the world. It isn't legal to print the modern versions of the traditional claims on the packaging in the UK, but outside of the Chinese cultural context, we buy and consume these products amid a growing and often baffling network of nutritional advice from family, friends, advertising, and multimedia in our information-soaked world. Exacerbating the problem of Chinese medicine going global is the current fashion for super or power foods that come with the promise of increased vitality, sexual vigor, youth, and longevity. Many of these claim an evidence base in modern science. Chinese green tea is advertised as rich in antioxidants, good for combating cancer. Garlic prevents bacterial infections. And here, Epimedium, Yin Yang Huo, or horny goat's weed, has the same active ingredient, although in very small dose, as Viagra. This apparently from watching a goat herd watching his goats after eating a lot of this. Many of the animal observations are mapped across to humans very clearly. There are certainly grains of truth in all these, not all of these characterizations, but many of the power foods like goji berry endure a very short celebrity status. The global market for superfoods is nothing if not faddish. And the aphrodisiac market aging Asian men is entirely reprehensible. Rhinoceros and deer horns, tiger bones and bear gourd are all animal products that carry with them the symbolism associated with the animal chi, the animal energy, and the power of the animals themselves. These kinds of links to sympathetic magic persist in the popular imagination and are clearly outdated and inappropriate today. But are all the myriad dietary prohibitions and recommendations the stuff of old wild wives' tales, the vestiges of a vanishing and irrational past? Here we have a court lady looking at things that she should look at in order to have a healthy pregnancy. I think she, or maybe increasing her breast milk here. I mean, we are told we should have our babies in the womb listen to Mozart these days. It's a similar kind of thing, training the fetus. To the modern eye, Chinese dietary traditions might seem overburdened with a history of ritual, religion, sexual law, and magic. To me, there are many truths to be found within that history despite. Those who seek precedence for modern science in early Chinese empirical knowledge have reason to believe that the Chinese diet included remedies for beriberi, goiter, night blindness, and rickets, linking symptoms and remedies. But Chinese dietary law is not so much a fixed set of beliefs, but a mobile set of shared social practices within which ordinary people can claim a certain expertise and simultaneously consolidate individual and community identities. It allows people to take control of their lives and their healths without recourse to any higher authority. In the immortal worlds of Jia Sixie, in the Qiminyao Shu, Every Man's Essential Arts of about 600 CE, I think I put it BC somewhere, but it's wrong. Yes, I didn't change it there, sorry. CE. The medieval householder and agriculturalist, when speaking about the complex history of Chinese prohibition, says it suffices to know the great principles without need to follow the meanderings in their smallest details. A wise comment which reveals strategies for dealing with the many systems of prohibition in practice. I'm going to end here. I have lots more on my PowerPoint. I can show you some of the reprehensible, I can show them very quickly actually to end. Reprehensible practices of elderly Asian men who have, I think these are pictures of from Guolizhuang, which is no longer there in North Beijing, but where they eat penises and ovaries and all sorts of things in order to stimulate sexuality and sexual vigor. There you go. Here is donkey penis served on a bed of lettuce. This is all courtesy of Fuchsia and my friend Jo Shun, who took these wonderful photographs. She's a vegetarian. I don't know what she was doing there. Yak penis for sexual alchemy. Henry's whip, sheep's penis on a cocktail stick. This is basically inhabited by wealthy Chinese businessmen and their secretaries. A platter of donkey and dog penises. Here is another place, I think also that Fuchsia and I have been in Chengdu, where some of really fine food is served, but this is the menu there, which they were very upset at me taking photographs of, because basically it's sort of secret, this menu. But here you have abalone with salmon sashimi for reinforcing your vital energy. So the nutritional advice is put there on the menu. Here, eliminating wind damp and strengthening the bones. You have wild goose from Qinshan. Again, you know, this is a nutritional, the product is given a particular place, and in sort of elite cuisine, you have to know where your food comes from in China. Here you have lemon and aloe, which is just to make you beautiful. and delicious duck web with mushroom to benefit the stomach and nourish the blood. And here, the dongchong xiao cao, the cordyceps for, what is it for? Kidney and benefiting your lung. I'm going to unshare my screen. And that's the end of my presentation.
Thank you very much, Vivian. That very wide-ranging presentation.
Not too much for a Sunday, for a Saturday, thank you very much. Saturday afternoon.
I just wanted to start by asking, because you've talked a lot about the ancient roots of Chinese nutritional therapy and that it's a mix between sort of empirically observed sort of cures and tonics and also magical thinking. And you also said at the beginning about how the younger generation were losing touch with this. And I think, and you also mentioned your impressions of actually the efficacy of Chinese nutritional therapy as a sort of preventative medicine, which very much tally with mine. And there is this tension in China between a sort of pride in Chinese traditional culture, which is now being very much promoted by the government as part of its soft power project, and also the idea that it's somehow old-fashioned and that Western nutritional theory and medicine is more advanced and scientific. There is this tension. And I just wondered, firstly, whether you think that any young people are sort of becoming aware of the value in their nutritional traditions and sort of showing an interest, and also whether the Chinese government, which is investing so much in promoting Chinese culture, sees nutritional therapy as part of something that should be promoted, or whether it's in the background.
Surely it does. I mean, it's selective. It's inevitably, at a national level, it's inevitably selective. And there is certainly a sort of social media presence which, where there are intergenerational, they're clearly intergenerational conflicts where, you know, people in old people's home are sharing all the prohibition culture, which is, you know, myriad, it's massive, the prohibition culture, and very complex and confusing. They share all of these, what you should eat and what you shouldn't eat and when you should eat it and when you should, and their kids are saying, "Mum, you're being crazy, this is nonsense, it's scientifically unprovable," which is probably true. They think about their food much more than the next generation do, who on the station concourse is eating McDonald's. They're the ones that are cooking. So, you know, what I'm trying to say is that as a social practice, it's something that is tremendously alive in that older generation. And it is being supported to a degree because, you know, some of it, there is modern science that backs it up. The government would be very proud of those sorts of things. And certainly there's not one single answer to this, because there's certainly middle-class urban kids who are tremendously proud of the nutritional culture and spend a lot of time learning about it, studying it. A lot of my students are tremendously invested in it. And the thing is, do we really need the tyranny of science to know that? I mean, really, the public health directives are, you should, modern psychology would tell us we should be taking time, we should be eating fresh food, seasonal food. We should take time with our friends and neighbors and our community to eat properly, and this will all do us good. So, you know, there are different ways in which you can assess the science. Here. Nationally, one just has to look at the responses to COVID. And, you know, Xi Jinping himself was recommending, what was it called? Angung Liu Huang, basically a Chinese formula for, and that's a remedy made up of a lot of foods and things that were also possibly medicines as well. But this boundary between food and medicine is really problematic because it's not problematic, but it's interesting because, you know, we think that it's a natural boundary, that one thing is a food, naturally a food, and another thing is a medicine. And that's based on a continuum of potencies that is from, you know, non-toxic to toxic to highly toxic on that kind of continuum. But in actual fact, where a food becomes a medicine is often a matter of professional divisions. So where is a food something that a doctor should prescribe rather than your mum? And this is not clear at all in China. And it actually isn't clear in Britain either.
It seems to me that it's the problem with Chinese nutritional therapy is that it's almost impossible to prove because it's holistic. It's yeah. like, I think you see in the Western media, you mentioned superfoods, that people in the West will seize on goji berries as a superfood, but they're seen in isolation as something you take for their benefits. But in China, it's a whole system. And it's just that, how do you narrow it down to things that you can analyze scientifically and prove?
It's always a problem as individual items become suddenly very famous and people don't know how to use them. You know, within their own cultures, there are often kind of regulations and traditions that constrain the use of things. You know, famously, there are certainly some substances in the Chinese materia medica, which when taken for long periods are damaging for sure. And when you isolate out the effective ingredients and stick them in a pill and serve them up as dietary products, you kill people easily, especially if they don't know the products themselves well, because, you know, often the people buy the wrong products. So, you know, there are any manner of problems with the superfood generation. But then, you know, in the Chinese materia medica and in the dietary, there are also lots of very valuable nutritional substances that can be isolated and used. And certainly, just like in Europe, a lot of traditional drugs become the drugs that are GPs. And I mean, the Artemisia story is very well known. The drug of question for malaria worldwide is stemmed from this history of Chinese use of Qinghao Artemisia for malaria or intermittent fevers. There's lots. I mean, as Mao said, it's a treasure house of the Chinese materia medica is a treasure house to be explored, and that's one way of thinking about it. But then the social way is another, and the way in which we lose touch with our traditions is lamentable for us nutritionally.
I just want to ask a question that's been cropping up in the chat in various forms.
Oh my God, there's 62 questions in the chat.
It's all right, it's been collated. Are you able to talk at all about the links, if any, between Chinese heating and cooling, yin-yang thinking, and, for example, Ayurvedic medicine and nutritional thinking in India, and also the more ancient European system of humours, the Galen theory, the ancient Greeks, you know, are there links between them?
Yeah, I think it's really, I teach at UCL a sort of undergraduate module on the history of Asian medicine, so where we do look at these kinds of things. I haven't looked at one set of foods and map them across to see if they're exactly the same. But there are, I think, in the same as, I ended with Jiao Xie just then, telling us that basically just follow the general principles. You don't have to stick with everything in its finest detail. And so the general principles are bitter herbs, bitter foods are cooling.
Is that in different tradition? I mean,
in general, it tends to be sort of universal, but it's never exact. The sweet foods are warming, bitter foods are cooling, salt takes things internally. I wouldn't say it's a universal science. And
are there historical links between Chinese ideas in this field and those to the west of China?
One of my most favorite books is the Yin Shan Jiang Yao. Do you know that? And Paul Buell has done a wonderful translation of it. And what you see is Arabic foods, Persian foods arriving in China with the Mongols. And there's one wonderful entry. It's written by a chef, Hu Sihui, at the Imperial Mongolian Court, and I'm not sure if he's Chinese or Mongolian, I forget, but essentially he's thinking about wolf, and because Central Chinese would never be seen eating wolf. You know, wolf is a savage thing to eat, but they're thinking, because the Mongol emperors, they probably want to eat wolf, and they're thinking, how do we classify wolf? And I think it says something like, wolf's a bit like dog, and they eat dog. So let's make it the same categories, put it in the same categories as wolf. So you see these ideas traveling. But what I think you're asking is Indian foodways. And do they arrive in China? And certainly they do, because they're arriving with the Buddhists. Certainly vegetarianism and prohibitions related to Buddhism are arriving in China too. Definitely. I mean, you know, that's the problem with anybody talking about Chinese food as if it's one thing. No, it's too fatty, it's too greasy, or all those things that you said at the beginning. You know, that's nonsense. You know, there's so much steamed food, and often, yes, a lot of what people think of as Chinese food is banquet food, but people don't eat banquet food every day. You know, banquet food is for banquets, and I'm sure you see how Chinese eat at banquets. It's very often very tiny, small amounts of food. Mm. They're not stuffing themselves. At the end of an academic banquet, which mostly academic banquets, they hardly eat anything. It's all left in the middle of the table. I feel like a pig.
You know, I went with a Chinese friend to the Fat Duck, the famous restaurant in Heston Blumenthal's restaurant, and we had the most astonishing banquet. I mean, an incredible feast, and it was dazzling, and it was brilliant, and it was beautiful, and we were completely stuffed at the end. And, we finished with several sweet courses. And at the end, my friend said to me, you know, Fuchsia, in China, even if we had a 40-course banquet, the menu is designed to be balanced, to end with a light soup or some fruit, so that even if you eat 40 courses, it takes you to a place where you feel very shufu, where your body is balanced. And she found it very strange that in this sort of Western haute cuisine, you would finish with a whole sequence of sweet and heavy and fatty foods.
What's the kind of phenomenology of the gut? You know, actually eating what makes you feel good is, you know, it's a fantastic science of the individual in China. And I think that's the key, really.
There's an interesting question here from Robin Toleno, who I think is in Canada, who mm-hmm. says, with such emphasis on dietetics in ancient China, why do we not have more written recipes from the ancient periods? Hello, Robin.
Hi, yes, I read your paper. I read your paper about, it's actually the only paper that I read. I've just sort of...
Thank you.
There are loads in the tombs. There are going to be more and more coming out of the tombs. We have the Hu Shishan recipes, which are a cookbook from, they're the ones that I think you're working on. And the Qimin Yao Shu is a fabulous recipe book. But essentially in the tombs, there are recipe collections, and clearly people were exchanging them at that time. And maybe not using them. It may be just like, you know, people collect cookery books today and they don't use them. You know, they read them. And I think that in ancient China, they were also reading cookery books as a matter of fun, but also they would collect them as a sign of conspicuous consumption, you know, as a prestige thing that you'd have cookbooks, because you could dream of eating even if you couldn't eat all those things. But do you have a view about...
At least in the received texts, the ones that have been transmitted through history, we don't seem to have received a lot of the early recipes. Mm. So I went looking for recipes and I didn't find a whole lot, but it sounds like there's hope in archaeology.
In archaeology, I think that there is great hope, but you know, how much, it's hard to know. There are a lot of medical recipes, remedies. But there are also cookbooks there too. Well, one mainly I know, but then the medical recipes, or they sort of a bit nutritional as well. So Harper's Mawandui medical manuscripts? They have some fabulous recipes in there. I am hoping, he and I have been talking about publishing. He's already translated the whole damn thing of the Qimin Yao Shu. I've been sitting on my desk for 10 years, and we've been talking about actually doing a popular version of that. So, but don't hold your breath. I do things very slowly.
I'd love to see that.
Yeah, I'm looking. He wants to do it with a chef. so that we can right. tease out all the issues, all the culinary issues there. So, you know, we both live that long.
Yeah. Can I just go back?
I hope you do get to it. Thank you.
Can I just ask one just little question, going back to right at the beginning of your paper, talking about restraint. And I just wondered, go back to our topic of herbs and spices, is in general in Chinese medicine, nutritional therapy, would you say there's a correlation between the idea of strong flavors with being actually unhealthy and excessive, and with lightly flavored foods as being healthy?
I think whenever you go to your Chinese medical doctor, they're going to tell you to eat less. Definitely, they're not going to tell you to eat more. But no, they may say eat more bitter flavors, less sweet flavors, or you know, no, definitely. Yeah, if you want drying foods, then there are, you know, the spicy foods are good. I don't think that it's an absolute prohibition, but on the whole, for people who are really ill, it's the congees for sure.
There's quite an interesting question also from Simon Majumdar asking about the class aspects, because certainly in China, there is a sort of, isn't there a more elite predilection for mild flavors? Hello, Simon. And folk food is more full of chilies and so on. So I don't know if that has any bearing on the medicinal thinking.
People from central China, from the Yellow River Valley, who were the people who considered themselves most Chinese, would say that they had a delicate digestion. They were people who did not work in the fields. They did not ride horses over long, long stretches of land. So therefore, they needed to cultivate themselves as more delicate, more vulnerable people. And so that's where you get this this sense that eating purer, plainer food is important. But then on the other hand, you do have this sense that eating lots of different flavors is a way of being powerful. You know, it's a way of demonstrating the fact that you own the world. You own the places where the spices are produced, and you own the trade routes. And so being able to banquet on those magnificent foods is also a way of being Chinese. And I see that amongst young Chinese too, that young Chinese come to London and they eat everything. And that's a mastery of the universe as well.
It's a demonstration of wealth. At that point, I think we'll have to end. And I don't know if we can go on chatting, but can I encourage everyone please to stay in this room, because we're going to go into, I think, the tea break. So there'll be a bit of music playing, but please don't leave. And can we just unmute everyone so we can all just say thank you very much to Vivian for a very fascinating presentation.
Thank you.
Well done.
Thank you.
I'm leaving though, because I want to get some food.
Beautiful. Wait, let me see. Okay.